Bismillah min ash-shaytanir rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inshallah, today we've been looking at the various types of habitat. Initially, we have discussed this habitat as a topic. However, because of the fact that we are engaged in some early morning class, which some of us have missed, so I'm deeming it fit for us to like take a recap on this topic. So we have known the types of habitats. We have known the definition of habitat as a place where living organisms are found. Now, majorly there are two types of habitats, namely the aquatic habitat and the terrestrial habitat. So we'll start looking at the aquatic habitat. What is an aquatic habitat? The first one, aquatic habitat, is an environment that's made up of water. Various water bodies are all examples of aquatic habitat. A very good example are the various rivers we have around us, the streams, the oceans. They are all examples of aquatic habitat. However, this aquatic habitat is further divided into two categories, namely the freshwater habitat and the marine or saltwater habitat. Initially, I told you we have basically two types of habitats, the aquatic habitat and the terrestrial habitat. And we are taking it one after the other. Now we are looking at aquatic habitat. We say that it's an environment that is made up of water. A very good example are the rivers, the sea, the oceans, the pond, the puddles. They are all examples of aquatic habitat. Now, this aquatic habitat, as I said earlier on, is basically of two types. We have the freshwater habitat and the marine habitat or the saltwater habitat. Now, let's take it one after the other. The freshwater habitat. Now, this freshwater habitat consists of relatively small water bodies, such as the rivers, the streams, the lakes, the lagoons, the ponds, the puddles, the dams, etc. The various small water bodies that we see around us, they constitute the freshwater habitat. And then basically, freshwater habitat is characterized with low salt concentration because of the fact that they contain relatively small amounts of salt or no amount of salt. They are termed freshwater habitats. Other major characteristics of freshwater habitats include, as I told you earlier on, it constitutes relatively small water bodies such as the rivers, the streams, the lake, the pond, the dams. Then another thing is that the volume of salt or the salt concentration in it is very small. It has a relatively low salt concentration, and that is why it is classified as a freshwater. Then, one thing also about this freshwater is that it allows light penetration. Sunlight penetrates easily within the freshwater. Also, another major feature of the fresh water is that there is seasonal variation in volume of water in those various water bodies that constitute the fresh water, such that during the rainy season, the water in those various fresh water bodies increases, and during the dry season, the volume decreases. Also, there is presence of dissolved oxygen around or within the freshwater habitat. All these, they are characteristics of fresh water. Remember, I told you it constitutes relatively small water bodies. It has low salt content. Light penetration is there. It allows for light penetration, and there is this seasonal variation of water in those freshwater body, and it has dissolved oxygen in the water. Now let's move forward looking at some examples of organisms that are present in the freshwater habitat. Examples of organisms that we can find in various freshwater habitat. A very good example is this pyrogyra. Another example is the water hyacinth and the water lily. They are all examples of freshwater organism plants that you can find in freshwater habitat. Animals also include tilapia fish, tadpole, some duck, and so on and so forth. There are also examples of animals that we can find in freshwater habitat. Now, these animals, there are some features they possess that make them to live successfully in this habitat. A very good example is the possession of mucilaginous cover. This is an adaptation that is present in the spirogyra. This enables or protects the spirogyra from water. Also, this water lily possess structures such as air bladder, intracellular air spaces, and they are also lightweight. This adaptation ensures that these plants, they are kept afloat. They are always floating in the water. And also, it helps them to maintain buoyancy in the water. And some other features of the hydrophyte. Now, animals in freshwater. One of these, I told you, a very good example is tilapia. One of the adaptive features of tilapia is that it possesses gills which enables it to breathe in water. Also, this tilapia can also have air bladder in it that helps to keep it afloat. The streamlined body nature also helps the tilapia to live successfully in this habitat. We also have the tadpole, like the possession of the gill, which enables the tadpole to live successfully in this habitat. Then you have some animals such as the duck, which possesses web feet. It possesses web feet, and these web feet enable the duck so that you are able to swim in water. The duck also possesses serrated beak that helps it to sift through the waters and obtain its food. All these, they are adaptive features of organisms that are present in the freshwater habitat. Now, we also look at examples of food chain, a typical food chain of a freshwater habitat. On the board here, from the example I gave you, you have the spirogyra. The spirogyra will be fed upon by the tadpole, while the tadpole will be fed upon by the tilapia fish, and the tilapia fish will be fed upon by the kingfisher. This is a typical example of a food chain in a freshwater habitat. Now, some factors that are prevalent in the freshwater habitat, they include some abiotic factors and some biotic factor. The list I have here include the plants, or otherwise known as the producer, the animals or the consumer, the parasite, the composers or microorganism, or sometimes called the saprophyte, the predators. From number 1 to 5, they are living factors that are affecting the freshwater habitat. Then we have other non-living factors that we term abiotic factor. These include temperatures, inorganic compounds that are present in water, turbidity or transparency, how transparent the water is, then dissolved oxygen, rainfall. They are all factors that are affecting the freshwater habitat. They are otherwise known as abiotic factors. All these, they are factors that are prevalent in the freshwater habitat. Now, we are moving forward to eutrophication. Eutrophication is a phenomenon whereby there is excessive growth of plants in the various water bodies. Usually this is due to increase in nutrients in that water, and this leads to the death of aquatic organisms. You know, there will be competition, and when this growth increases, it can lead to the death of aquatic organisms. This phenomenon is known as eutrophication. I said earlier that eutrophication is the phenomenon whereby there is excessive growth of plants or algae in water bodies, and this is usually due to increase in organic nutrients in that water, and thereby leads to the death of the aquatic organism in that water body. Usually, the causes of eutrophication are more, but mostly one of it identified is usually due to excessive use of fertilizer. And when there is excessive use of this fertilizer, this is channeled by underground water into the various water body. And as this happens, there is excessive growth of plants or algae in the water body. This process is known as eutrophication. Now, another causes of eutrophication is as I said earlier on, excessive use of fertilizer, and another thing is disposal of sewage in various water body also leads to eutrophication. When sewage are being disposed uncontrollably in the water bodies, it can also lead to eutrophication. And one of these consequences of eutrophication is that it kills the aquatic life in that water. Also, the water body, as we all know, water is also a means of transportation. It inhibits or it serves as an obstacle to water transportation. This is an effect of eutrophication. Now, we are moving forward to the second type of habitat, which is known as marine habitat or saltwater habitat. What is a saltwater habitat? The saltwater habitat is a type of water aquatic habitat or a water body that contains, in which the water contains high amount of salt, in which the salinity of the water is high. When I say salinity, it means the degree of saltness in that water or the concentration of salt in the water. Now, marine habitat consists majorly of the various deep oceans and sea that we have. Now, what are the characteristics of this saltwater habitat? One of it, which is what we use in defining it, is that the salinity is high, is on the high side. And also the turbidity, let me say turbidity, is the degree of transparency of the water. The salinity is usually high, as well as the turbidity. And one thing about these marine habitats is that the temperature decreases with depth. As you go inner into the sea, the temperature decreases, unlike in the freshwater habitat. Now, also, we have light penetration, which is limited to the surface water. Now, this is a characteristic of the marine habitat, whereas in the fresh water, there is light penetration is allowed, it circulates within the water. But in this marine habitat or the saltwater habitat, the light penetration is limited to the surface because of the high density of the water and the high turbidity. So the water can, the light cannot easily pass through. As such, it's limited to the surface water. Now, you also have that oxygen concentration decreases with depth. The concentration of oxygen, as you go deeper into the sea, it decreases with depth. Also, you have factors such as ocean current, wave, tide. They are very common in the marine habitat. Ocean current is the regular movement of water, of large water bodies around the world. Then you have waves, which is the movement, vigorous movement of water as a result of wind. Then you have tide, which is the alternate rise and fall of the volume of water in the sea. This alternate rise and fall happens during the day and in the night. Now we are moving forward to examples of food chain in a marine habitat. We have diatoms, crabs, from crabs to tilapia fish, and from tilapia fish to shark. This is a typical example of food chain in the marine habitat. But before we move to that, let's look at some adaptive features of organisms in the marine habitat. As I told you, that one of the prevalent factors in the marine habitat is that the water contains high amount of salt. So most organisms found in this habitat, they have adaptive features that make them to be able to succeed and live successfully with this condition. One of these is that some of the plants, they possess succulent stem or roots. What they use it to do, they store water in order to dilute these salt in the water environment where they find themselves. Another adaptive feature is that some of the plants possess breathing roots that they use in breathing in atmospheric air. As we know, as it has been noted, that the oxygen concentration decreases with depth. So the plant devises their homing adaptively such that they have breathing roots that they use in receiving oxygen from the atmosphere. Now, some of them possess viviparous seedlings. Viviparous seedling is a type of seed that germinates while still in the fruit, anchored to the plant. While they are still on the plant, while the fruit is still on the plant, this type of seed usually germinates. So, most marine habitat plants, they possess viviparous seedlings such that they will continue to survive. Also, there is presence of stilt root for anchoring. All these, they are features for them to survive in this salty environment. So we have other adaptive features also in animals. For example, the shark and the dogfish, they have the ability to retain the urea in their body in order to cope with the high salinity of the ocean, to balance between the salt content in them and that in the water where they live. Also, some other organisms, such as the tilapia and the herring's fish, they have ability, or they are able to secrete, they have a salt secreting gland in their head that helps them to maintain osmotic regulation. Also, we have in crab that such that they are, can easily burrow into mud against wave action. All these are adaptive features for them to live successfully in the habitats they find themselves. Are we there? We are still looking at adaptive features of organisms in the marine or saltwater habitat. I've talked about the food chain in the marine habitat as well as some factors that affect the marine habitat. We have the temperature, the wind, the salinity. We have turbidity is also a factor that is affecting marine habitat. Now we are looking at the major zones in the marine habitat. Under this, I refer you to some of your textbook to see the diagram of the major zones in the marine habitat. If you have your essential biology, you can go there, browse through it, you see this diagram. If you have your modern biology, you can see this diagram there. So we have six major zones known as the supratidal or the splash zone, the intertidal zone, the littoral zone, the benthic zone, the abyssal zone, and the hadal zone. All these zones, they are shared according to their distance and some other factors. So look at these zones one after the order. The first one, the supratidal zone or the splanch zone. It is the zone that is exposed to the surface, and this is the zone that is usually moistened by splashes when the wave hits the shore of the ocean. That part of the ocean that you can still see sand on it. However, when the wave hits the shores of this ocean, this zone is usually wet by the splashes from the wave. This area is known as the splash or supratidal zone. Organisms found here include, you can find periwinkles there, you can find barnacles, you can also find algae. They are all examples of organisms that you can find in this splash zone. The next zone, which is known as the intertidal zone. In the intertidal zone, it is the zone that is usually exposed whenever there is low tide, but is covered by water whenever there is high tide. Remember, I told you that tide is the regular or is the alternate rise and fall in the volume of ocean water, and it usually occurs alternatively in the day and night. So when the tide is high, those parts that is covered by water, and when the tide is low, that part of the water after the shore that is usually exposed is known as the intertidal zone. This zone has high photosynthetic activity because of the fact that it is directly connected to sunlight. So there is the photosynthetic rate in that zone is very, very high. Examples of plants you can find there, they include the kelp, the sargassum, and some animals such as the sea anemone, the mussel, etc. Another name also for this zone is known as the planktonic zone or the euphotic zone. Then the third zone is known as the littoral or subtidal zone. The zone is found immediately after you leave the intertidal zone, and it is about 200 meters deep. It is the part that covers the continental shelf. My geography students, they understand more what we understand by continental shelf. Now, one thing about this zone is that it also receives sunlight, and there is abundant nutrients because of the fact that it is a zone that you have remains of some remnant there. Then the temperature, salinity, and water, they don't vary, unlike what you have in the nitritic zone. You know, in the intertidal zone, you have that there is rise and fall in water level according to the tide. That when the tide is low, you have the area being exposed, and when the tide is high, the area is usually covered with water. As a result of this, the availability of water fluctuates, the salinity also fluctuates, and the temperature of the intertidal zone also fluctuates. However, here in the subtidal zone, the water availability, the salinity, and the temperature, they don't fluctuate. Animals that can be found there include the starfish, the sea urchin, the crabs, and crayfish. You also have others. Plants you can find there include the diatoms, the kelps, etc. Then the fourth one, the benthic or the benthial zone. This benthic or benthial zone is about 500 meters deep. Here, there is no producer, no green plant, because of the fact that the light penetration is low or not there. So as a result of that, there is very low or no photosynthetic activity. So examples of animals that are found include the paramecium, fish, crabs, shrimps, etc. Then the fifth zone, known as the abyssal or the pelagic zone. This is the zone that is found deep down the sea. there is low temperature. Why? Because it is very deep inside the sea. And remember, as I told you, when we are looking at the characteristics of the ocean, that temperature decreases with depth. As you go deeper, the temperature decreases. So as such, 700 meters deep, it has a very low temperature and there is no light penetration. Remember, I told you that the turbidity of the ocean water is very, very high, and as such, light does not easily penetrate to this depth, and there is no photosynthetic activity. However, primary production of food in that environment is by chemosynthesis. Also, some animals also obtain their food by scavenging. They eat remains of food that other organisms from the upper layer throws down the ocean. So these remains are known as detritus. So they feed on these detritus for their food. Examples of organisms we can find here include the shark, octopus, sponges, etc. Yeah. And the last zone, known as the hadal or aliphatic zone. This hadal or aliphatic zone is the ocean bed. It is the bed or the floor of the ocean. It is over 7,000 meters deep. It has no light penetration and no photosynthetic activity. Animals that you can find there, they include the echinoderms such as the starfish and the shrimps. They are examples of animals we can find in the hadal or aliphatic zone. Remember, I told you, it's deep down the ocean, it's the ocean floor, and it has no light penetration, and it has no photosynthetic activity. So, based on two things that we have been looking at so far, say light penetration and the depth. Based on the depth and light penetration, the marine habitat is grouped into three zones, known as the euphotic zone, the dysphotic zone, and the aliphatic zone. Now, this euphotic zone ranges from the surface to 200 meters deep. At this zone, it is the zone that receives the abundant or the largest amount of sunlight because it is directly connected to the sun. And this zone has both producers, a green plant, consumers, and decomposer. You will expect that the photosynthetic activity of this place is very, very high. Now, the second zone, known as the dysphotic zone, ranges from 200 meters to 400 meters. Where the euphotic zone ends, so it begins at 200 meters to 400 meters down the ocean. So the zone receives very dim light. So it has only consumers and decomposers. Animals at this zone, they can withstand cold, low temperature. You know, I told you, temperature decreases with there. So the temperature of this area is very, very low. So they can withstand high temperature because they can also withstand high pressure. Pressure increases with depth in the marine water. So animals in this zone, they can usually withstand cold and high pressure. A very good example of this animal are the octopus and the squid. Then you have lastly the aliphatic zone. This zone is the ocean floor, is the bed of the ocean. It receives no light. Therefore, it is also known as the midnight zone. It begins from where the dysphotic zone ends to 7,000 meters. It is known as the midnight zone because the place is usually dark because there is no light penetration, and as such, there is no photosynthetic activity. Animals found there include the shark, squid, octopus, and so on. All these, they are the three major zones in which the marine habitat is divided into. Then we have a type of habitat known as the estuary habitat. An estuarine habitat is a body of water that is located between a salt water and a fresh water environment. It is also formed where a river enters or empties its contents into a sea. That is how an estuarine habitat is found. Usually, most characteristics of estuarine habitat is like those of the river. However, it is usually brackish in nature because of the fact that salt and fresh water are mixing, and the bottom is usually made up of soft mud because of the fact that when the river is coming, as it empties or tends to empty its content into the river, it's carrying debris. So these debris are dropped as an extra inside the estuary. Then the volume of the estuary usually vary with tide, and there is low oxygen content in the tide in the estuary. However, the estuary usually carries or have abundant nutrients in it because of the fact that it is carrying alluvial soil. So estuarine habitat usually carries abundant soil. Examples of food chain in estuary is like that of food chain in a typical fresh water. Organisms found there are usually like that in the fresh water. Then some factors affecting an estuary also affect a river. They are common to both river and estuary. On this note, I'm going to stop here. Inshallah, in our next class, we'll look at terrestrial habitats and we'll call it a day on habitats. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, shalla la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka.